Welcome to another edition of Journey of Hope. Thrilling stories of former patients that have been impacted by the healing ministry of Loma Linda University Medical Center. People that have overcome and not only been thrivers, but have been not only been survivors, but thrivers. And our special guest today is Dr. Terry Wepsick and his wife, Carmi. Terry is a pathologist, especially in cancer biology and tumor immunology. Terry and Carmi, it's good to have you here. And we've got people from all around the world that are watching today. And we want to learn a little bit about your background and tell us about where you came from and your educational background. Just begin to share with our patients here.
I was very lucky to be raised in a family where father was an educator, but he was a son of a coal miner. And so he made the jump. He was the person who made the educational jump. My brother went to medical school, and I figured if he could do that, I could probably accomplish the same thing. So I was fortunate to go to Yale Medical School after attending Wesleyan University. I found in medical school that I really preferred to learn new things, not the same routine stuff. And I liked to do medical research specifically. So I gravitated towards that. I did a fellowship year in Stockholm at the world-famous Karolinska Institute in immunology. And then I was taken into the public health service and spent 2 years in Washington doing medical research in cancer biology at the National Institutes of Health at the National Cancer Institute. Following that experience, I...
Now, how long were you there?
I was there 2 years.
2 years.
2 years.
Right,
and following that experience, I decided that I would continue to pursue a career in academic medicine. So I went into pathology. Pathology is the study of systematic study of disease in all forms. I figure if they cure heart disease, I could do cancer. If they cure cancer, I could do heart disease. And so it was actually...
You'd always have something to be doing.
Always had something, some work to do. And I went to San Diego to do my training. And I completed my training relatively quickly because I had a lot of research training in the past and a lot of publications. So I joined the faculty there in 1972, stayed with them from 72.
And this was the where now?
University of California, San Diego,
okay.
At the Veterans Hospital, and stayed with them for about 9 years. And then I moved to Chicago to become head of the research program at Loyola Medical School in the Department of Pathology, and to also be a pathologist at the Veterans Hospital.
In Chicago?
In Chicago.
Okay.
And I was there until 1989, about 8 years. Probably the coldest 8 years of my life, knowing Chicago.
All right, and then you had to get out of there.
Had to get out of there, but I did meet my wonderful wife in Chicago, Carmela. So, and so that was a
wonderful things happen in Chicago.
Wonderful things can happen in Chicago. Love is alive in Chicago. And then I moved out to University of California, Irvine, to Long Beach Veterans Hospital. And I was the chief of the Department of Pathology at the Veterans Hospital and a professor at the University of California, Irvine. Throughout my career, I've had opportunities to grow and work with people, and people's work and enjoy helping out efforts that I identify. So I was moved to the position of chief of staff at the Veterans Hospital in Long Beach in 1991. And we
had to be a young man at that time.
I was approaching 50.
All right.
So
I was solidly
in the middle age.
Yeah,
you know, there aren't too many 100-year-olds walking around. Yeah. And but I continued to do a lot of medical research during my entire career. I've had the opportunity to teach medical students for over 30 years, probably in excess of a couple hundred students a year.
Really?
You know,
over
and,
30 year period.
Over 30 year period. So I was teaching basic pathology as well as a specialist in cancer immunology. And my journey was sort of cut a little short. In terms of academic pursuits, by doing an awful lot of administrative work for the Veterans Hospital. But I was able to turn a hospital that was pretty mediocre into a first-class facility.
Really?
With the efforts of all the employees, really working with us to make veterans care something we could all be proud of.
Where are you from originally?
I was raised in Pennsylvania.
In Pennsylvania. And left there in your early
left
childhood?
There, yeah, I left there when I was 18 to go to college.
Okay.
And I went to Wesleyan, which is in Connecticut. Yale's in Connecticut. And then I went to Washington, D.C., and then San Diego and Chicago.
A lot of the East Coast, and then you went to Chicago. Right. Carmi, where are you from?
I'm from the Chicago area.
Okay. Well, you also thought it was time to migrate west and been enjoying the better weather out here. As you were going on in your profession and helping other people identify particular types of cancers, and apparently you've worked on many different types and identified, what's some of the kind of work that you have done?
Well, my work initially is in the immune response to cancers, identifying how does the body react and create an immune response to cancer, and can you immunize against cancers? And so I've done some very fundamental work in that area, identifying which cells react against tumor cells. One of the clinical applications that came out of my work was the use of BCG to treat bladder cancer. And this is certainly the first step in the treatment of bladder cancer. I did a fair amount of work in early diagnosis of malignancies, looking at blood markers, and developed a radioimmunoassay for a compound called alpha fetoprotein. And that protein is secreted by liver cancers, testicular cancers
as well. So you're able to identify them?
Identify the presence of the tumor just by taking a sample of blood.
Really?
And so that led also to identification of birth defects in women who are pregnant. So that was one area that I worked on. I also expanded on what I call the negative regulators of the immune response. For every positive response, there's a negative response. And I was able to identify what were some of the cells that were stimulated by cancers to create a negative response so that would allow the tumor to grow. And so if you can downregulate those negative regulators,
make some kind of an impact,
then you can have an impact on the positive inhibition of the growth of the tumor.
Well, there's all kinds of research that's been going on during the last 20 years, and particularly during the last 10 years, and sounds like you've been an exciting part of some of the discoveries that have been made. And then one day, you apparently thought it was time for a physical. How did you discover that?
I had been watching my PSA and go up, and my prostate had had enlargement over the years.
Now, what's a PSA? Because we got people watching.
PSA is a tumor marker protein for prostates. And it's a factor that is excreted into the blood. And the elevation occurs when you have a tumor present or when you have an enlarged prostate.
So even an enlarged prostate,
can cause a rise. Or an infection in the prostate.
Okay.
But if you monitor it carefully over a period of time and get baseline levels, when you see elevations of a certain degree, more than 0.75 units, then you know that something might be brewing. And you need to carefully look to see whether or not there's a cancer there. Prostate cancer affects 1 in 6 men, so it's a very common cancer. And as you get older, which we all do, then we often have an increased incidence in later life for prostate cancer. So my PSA had jumped to about 3.8 to 4.0.
Which is not really high, is
not,
it?
Not super high, but it's a...
That used to be the parameter where people would take a look, but they've lowered that. What has it been lowered to?
Well, we now like to look at about 3.4.
Okay.
And if you have an elevation of more than 0.75 in a one-year period, then you need to carefully look at the and do biopsies. So I thought it was time to do biopsies, and my...
Yours had risen a little bit.
Mine had risen. My primary physician concurred with that opportunity, and the urologist also said, okay, fine, you know, we'll just look for it. The interesting part is that I can look at my own biopsies. You know, I can't do the biopsy, but I can look at
it. You can look at it, so you looked at your own slides.
So I looked at my own slides after somebody overlooked them, and saw that there was a small focus of cancer there. I had 1 out of 12 biopsies positive.
So just a teeny bit of cancer.
Just a small amount of cancer, you know. So at that point, it's, you know, you shouldn't announce to your wife over the telephone that you have a teeny bit of cancer.
While she's driving.
That was not the best thing to do. You know, it was sort of a little upsetting for her. But you know, being a specialist and being a cancer doctor who advises other people about cancer treatment, I certainly had to take my own advice and carefully look at things.
Now, I mean, when we talk about a teeny bit of cancer, it's like being a teeny bit pregnant. I mean, you've got cancer.
Right.
And I don't remember how many samples you had taken.
usually you take about 12.
Yeah, and sometimes people get one or two or three. And really, that's kind of like a needle in a haystack, isn't it? Because you come back and you get one sample that says you've got cancer in a particular area. It doesn't mean that you don't have more cancer in other areas.
No, that's right. But there's sort of statistical analysis that says if you sample 12 to 16 biopsies,
you're going to have
a pretty good sample of the entire prostate.
So yours actually came back. Now, you're driving along when you get the news. How does that make an impact upon you?
Well, I was in the midst of my teaching career, and I was on my way home, and it was around the Christmas season, and I was a music director, so I was under a lot of pressure to start with.
And had a program coming up.
I had lots of programs coming up, and my very scientific husband said, "Honey, I have cancer." He left nothing to be discovered, later on. So I pulled off the road and, had myself a bit of a cry. And then he said, "But we're gonna find out the best way to deal with this." And he said that I would be with him every step of the way, which is exactly how it happened. So
you kind of just made the announcement. I mean, you're dealing with facts and matter all the time. Hey, I got cancer.
Right.
Thought you ought to know, honey. I got cancer. Hello, are you still there?
Right.
That's right.
That's exactly how it happened.
Yeah.
And you're kind of like a bomb has been dropped on
you. Yes.
I mean, he's been dealing with cancer, and the results of cancer. I mean, when people are diagnosed with the big C, it's a sobering, frightening experience.
Right.
And I tell our patients here that, you've been diagnosed with cancer. It's not a death sentence.
Right.
You've been diagnosed with cancer. And many people, they begin concentrating on the cancer and the fact that all of a sudden their mortality is looming at them, They've been hearing the clock ticking louder than ever before. And I tell the people, don't be concentrating on dying. Concentrate on living.
Right.
Well, I think that's the key thing is you have to understand that this is a complete journey, and you will end the journey at some point in time.
The only thing that's 100% is mortality. Exactly.
Right. I always say biology wins.
That's right.
It's just a matter of time.
It's a matter of time.
And so this is what I call a middle C cancer. It's not like lung cancer or stomach cancer or pancreatic cancer. It's a middle C cancer. It's a cancer like prostate and breast and colon and bladder. These are cancers that we can treat. We can learn to be living with them, and accommodate to a sort of a chronic disease state if necessary. And then there are even the small Cs. There's small skin cancers that aren't going to kill you, but they're going to be inconvenience, and they'll require you to visit your dermatologist and wear a spot in your face for once in a while.
See, and that's a pathologist that's talking.
Yeah. Right?
Small C, big C, middle C. But when you got the C, it's nothing
C.
but a big C.
Right.
So you were diagnosed. So, what kind of a journey did you go on? I mean, was it just a matter of fact, or did you, you had obviously some options.
Yeah, I knew more about the biology of cancer and the fundamental gene defects that occur in cancers and the immune response and the actual treatment of prostate cancer. So I carefully reviewed the literature and started looking at all the options. And because I have been blessed by having a rich career in medicine, notwithstanding a few failures along the way, because you need a few failures to be successful.
That's part of the learning experience.
That's part of the learning experience. And I'm very successful at things the second time. But I wanted this to be only one-time shot at treatment. So I looked at surgery. Laparoscopic surgery is a decent form of treatment. It was just coming into treatment 5-6 years ago. And it was being done by Dr. Menon at the Henry Ford Hospital. And he was training other physicians how to do laparoscopic or da Vinci surgery. But I thought this was a pretty small tumor, and I didn't feel I needed to think about the side effects of surgery for dealing with this small cancer. Prostate tumors that tend to occur in the periphery of the gland. So if you're interested in curing them, you have to be concerned about the outside of the gland.
Right on the border.
Right on the border, where it's at, where it's growing from the periphery. I did go to the Seattle Prostate Institute and looked at brachytherapy up there.
Which is one of the finest institutions really in the
great,
world.
Great institute
for treating that
prostate
way.
Cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And Peter Grimm was up there, and he was very congenial. And since I'm senior in my field, I can get a fair amount of respect just by even showing up for evaluation, which they did a good job. But I wasn't convinced that the radiation dose could be calibrated for the periphery of the gland. I looked a little bit at external beam irradiation, But the physics of external beam irradiation mean that there's a lot of rays that go elsewhere into the body. They go into the side effect profile area and not directly at the prostate. And then I came out to Loma Linda, and that was a wonderful opportunity because I knew some people had been treated out here. I knew a little bit about the methodology. I'd read about it. But I came out to be evaluated. And the first person who walks in to meet me was one of my former students, Dr. Carl Rossi.
You mean the physician there?
The physician, yeah.
Okay.
And he walks in and he says, "I think I know you." And I said, I really know you." You know, I told him where he went to medical school at Loyola in the 80s, and I remembered him, and he remembered me. So we hit it off relatively well.
So your student becomes your physician.
Right. Yeah. He had a hard time with that. Yeah, he had a hard time, and because I am pretty senior and published a lot of material, he had a hard time understanding that I was looking to him for guidance, that it was his turn to become the teacher. But he did a good job. So.
Well, and Carmi, you were here. Tell us the impact of coming to Loma Linda. I mean, it's a couple's disease when
right.
you have prostate cancer. And so you ended up coming here. And tell us about the journey that you were here.
Well, I think I want to start with the fact that Terry involved me on the journey from the very, very beginning. So when we went to the urologist, I went with, and we sat in the office, and we got the explanation of the disease and what it was all about. And I patiently listened and let Terry do the talking, and then we would discuss it afterwards. And then we went on to Seattle and went there and visited with the physicians at the clinic there and learned all about that. And so I was becoming very educated along the way. And then the other research he did on the internet or by phone. And then when we found out about Loma Linda and we walked into Dr. Rossi's office, I was there. And I think that that's probably the best part of the journey is that I was there from the beginning and was able to understand what was going on. Of course, when you're married to Terry and he's explaining everything, you know, that helps a lot too. But I think any wife can be part of this process, or any spouse or significant other should be part of the process.
Very important.
And from the very beginning, you know, not concealing anything from the beginning, but be there from the beginning so that you understand. And when we got to Loma Linda, and I was still working, and we live about 65 miles south of Loma Linda, so Terry opted to drive, and I said, "Would you like me to stop working so I can be there for you when you come home, and what will it be like, and all this?" And he said, "No, I think you can continue to work." And so that's exactly what happened. He went on to the treatment, and I was there, and he actually made dinner for me by the time I got home because he was treated early. But the experience was gentle and loving and kind, and that's what he talked about every day when he came home.
Well, we got a few pictures to take a look at that you're able to experience some things because of the treatment that you went through. And we're talking about how many years ago?
It's about 6 years.
It's about six
about
years
six
ago.
Years.
So let's take a look at some of these pictures. This first one is where?
This is in the harbor where we live, Huntington Harbor, on our sailboat. This is my granddaughter, Sarah, and her dad, Alan.
All right.
And this is in the Whitsunday Islands with our friends Chuck and Jan. We're on sailing in a catamaran in a rally over there, a major rally. This is the famous Bob Marchini giving a hug to Dr. Websick.
All right.
And Bob Marchini is certainly an ambassador for Loma Linda, but he is one special guy.
He is an amazing individual.
He is actually committed 8 years plus to tell people about cancer.
Yeah.
And he's written a wonderful book, which is You Can Beat Prostate Cancer, and you don't need surgery to do it. And the book is very well written and medically accurate because I got a chance to read it before it went to press.
kind of reviewed it here, huh?
Yeah.
This is what now?
This is sailing off the Chesapeake. We were in a rally going south with two other boats, and this is a Seawind catamaran sailing down the Chesapeake Bay. This is Carmela and myself in Mexico after an Ensenada race. And having a good time there. We actually finished well that year.
Did you?
Yeah, I think we got a second overall.
All right.
This is in Sydney Harbor. This is at the Royal Sydney Pirate Squadron Yacht Club. And that is the Burgee that was flown by, on the left, which is the flag is called Burgee. And that's the Francis Chichester Burgee, sailed by Sir Francis Chichester when he sailed around the world.
On
the Gypsy Moth. And that Burgee was from their club.
It's
the original Burgee from the Sydney Harbour Yacht Club. These are petroglyphs from the Aboriginals in Australia. We visited Australia for about 5 weeks. We love to travel. That's part of our journey, is to share life with other people and recognize that other people's needs are pretty much our needs. I think that the world's too small not to recognize that.
You're absolutely right.
And so people want basically the same things in life. They want peace of mind. They want their health. And they really don't want to want.
Yeah, right.
And if you give people those three things, then they will be able to navigate the rest of life with a lot of joy. This, we have crocodile crossings in Australia and the crocodile safety. So you don't go near the water very much in Australia because the saltwater crocodiles will eat you. It's really there. These are anthills. This is a small anthill, actually, in Australia. A termite hill. And we're always covered up trying to prevent skin cancer, as you can see. This is on a remote island called the Great Keppel Island. And this was the one sunny day out of seven that we stayed on this island. And we went there, and the Australians were kind of laughing at us because there aren't many people on this island. There are about eight people on this island.
Really?
And so we had all of our own provisioning and everything over. But it was planning to be raining for 6 out of 7 days. So we filled up their water tanks. This is obviously the Sydney Harbour area with the Opera House in the background. This is in Melbourne area. We met another Proton Bob patient in Melbourne.
And they're all around the world.
All around the world. And we went out wine tasting with him to celebrate successful treatment of prostate cancer.
Oh, that is great. So. And we do. I think there are former patients, Bob members, that are in 25 countries around the world and all 50 states.
Well, this is another yacht club. What we do is we exchange our Burgee, our flag, with their flag. This is in Melbourne, and the Royal Melbourne Yacht Club. And these yacht clubs go back hundreds of years. So you walk inside, they're just famous.
A lot of history there.
The Olympics in Melbourne were held at this club.
Is that right?
This is Carmen, myself, in Mexico, again celebrating the joy of life together.
Okay.
This is outside the Aboriginal area. You have to go in a four-wheel drive vehicle to these areas. And you have to have a guide. It's forbidden. Now, this is a real termite. That's a major termite.
That's a termite castle.
Yeah, that's right. You don't want to have this in your house. You see this much in your house.
Right. That looks like the captain.
I'm sitting in the back of a Seawind catamaran, which is made in Australia, just relaxing. And probably the auto helm is steering the boat. Similar picture to us. We have a friend that sells these boats, so every once in a while he'll call us and say, I need some help transporting a boat from here to there. And of course, we always raise our hand and say, sure, we'll sail from Annapolis to Charleston.
Glad to help out. Okay.
So,
go ahead.
This is my wife. We're kissing each other in a monastery of all places.
In Greece,
probably after eating some sweet Greek pastry. So it's been a great journey, but I think the surprising part to me, Lynn, is I'm part of the Loma Linda family. And by that I mean that, I've met the Slaters, I know them. We've actually published some joint publications together now. I understand the tenacity and the due diligence that Dr. Slater had to go through to build this center. And he's a truly unique individual. I put him in the category of a Jonas Salk or somebody of that nature. And I know he doesn't toot his horn that well, but protons would have really not come into treatment without his efforts. And now we're having proton centers built throughout the world. A lot of centers being built in the United States, treating a wide variety of diseases, a lot of brain lesions and other things that are very specific for targeting. But beyond that, I counsel patients all the time.
Well, I know we have people coming here all the time that have ended up being diagnosed. They hear about you, they make contact with you, right. And then you kind of lead them through a process, and then they end up coming here. In fact, we have some patients that are currently being treated that made contact with you. Well, as we're coming down to the final couple minutes here, Carmi, there are many wives that are looking and watching, and their husband has just been diagnosed. What would you tell them?
I would tell them that they have hope and that cancer can save your life. And that's kind of always been my motto now that Terry's been through it, because it's not, as you said, it's not the end. You're not looking at the death part of it. You're looking at the life part of it. And I think they should understand that it's a process and that it's frightening at times. But I think they need to gather information and make wise decisions and take a deep breath and hang in there. And that goes for all the other significant others that are part of the process with their mates that are going through treatment.
They're in it together. And people that come to Loma Linda, I remind them that the treatment takes place either in the gantry, in the fixed beam line, but healing is a process.
Right.
And it's a journey. And life itself is a journey. And while people are here, they're involved in many, many different activities. And they go on and they overcome the cancer and they overcome the fear that they've had. And the last thing we want is for people to come here and be treated and be cured for their cancer and then find out that a year later they had a stroke or a heart attack. And that's why we're talking about balance and try to get people involved. Well, it's obvious because of your treatment and because of your background and your knowledge that you've gone on and you've been traveling around the world and you're meeting people and you're helping people. And that's an important part of life itself, is reaching out and touching and making an impact upon other people. I want to thank you for being with us here on Journey of Hope and for Loma Linda Medical Center and for the LLBN. I'm Lynn Martell. We want to welcome you again to the program and encourage you to be watching next week. And for those of you that have just been confronted with some kind of a trauma, God has a plan for you.